Ms. Vaasanthi holds a postgraduate certificate of merit in developmental studies from the University of Oslo, Norway. She's a writer and journalist and has written several novels, short stories, travelogues and columns in both English and Tamil. She worked as editor of India Today, the Tamil edition, for 10 years and obviously has observed the political scene in Tamil Nadu very keenly. Her works have been translated into several Indian languages as well as international, like Dutch, Czech, and Norwegian. Two of her novels were filmed in Malayalam. She has also received several awards, including the Uttar Pradesh Sahitya Samsthan Award and Punjab Sahitya Academy Award for her novels translated into Hindi and English, respectively. Her book on Tamil Nadu politics, titled Cutouts, Caste and Cine Stars, was published by Penguin India. Her next book for Penguin, titled Jayalalitha, A Portrait, received a court order against its release. Recently, Juggernaut Publications brought out a short biography of Jayalalitha, written afresh by her, titled Amma, Jayalalitha's journey from movie star to political queen. Okay, so with that, Vaasanthi, could you, before we begin talking about the book, could you give us a background to why the earlier book was not allowed to be published?
Well, Penguin approached me to write a biography on Jayalalitha, and I was very hesitant. I first refused them flatly. I said, no, oh no, I can't write. Because as you yourself said, I was very keenly watching Tamil Nadu politics for 10 years and at least two of her regimes very closely. And I knew what kind of a person she was. And she would, he was the most intolerant chief minister one has seen. You know, she, you know, you have heard of the kind of defamation suit she put against so many newspapers and all that. And while I was the editor, I used to be very critical of her.
Okay.
You know, I used to write a regular column every week, and then I wouldn't spare her at all. Of course, I didn't spare any politician who became controversial.
Good
and
for you.
But then the other politicians appreciated my writing. I should say that about Tamil Nadu. But I think Jayalalitha just ignored me.
Okay.
You know, she had this tendency of giving value only to English writing. So I was writing in a Tamil weekly.
Okay.
And then Tamil she just ignored. Because I think from the beginning she had this ambition of becoming a national leader and getting into the national stream, political stream. But then, so I hesitated and I didn't want to write. But then my earlier book that Penguin brought did very well, and so Penguin insisted. And then, you know, the usual flattery you hear, they said, oh, if you can't write, who else can, and all that. And so I succumbed to it ultimately, and then I said, okay, I'll write. But it became very difficult because she was a very complex person and very secretive, and I couldn't even get in touch with her old associates, schoolmates and her relatives. No one would speak, and I couldn't even locate her friends. I thought, you know, for about 6 months I struggled to get in touch with all these contacts. Then I was about to give it up when I then got this, you know, some link to her schoolmates. So I went and met.
So built your story on.
Yeah,
that.
Built my story on. And then a lot of things that they said, you know, that were not known to the general public.
Okay.
But other things that I have written in the book were already in the public domain. She has herself written her biography, autobiography, in a Tamil journal during the 70s. Which
so
was,
did you borrow anything from what
of
she
Of course, yes. It was all, I mean, her own writing. So it must be authentic.
Yes, of course.
So, but then it was abruptly stopped for reasons known only to her and to MGR, maybe her mentor. And then I wrote this book, but I kept it as a secret. I didn't want this news to spread at all.
Okay.
But unfortunately, what happened, just before the release, I worked on this book for 2 years, and the book was ready, the release, the launch date was announced, and then this Outlook magazine thought they, it would be a curtain raiser, you know, and then it would be a scoop, they thought. They correspondent came and interviewed me, but when it appeared in the book, it didn't appear as an interview. It came as a kind of excerpts from the book.
Okay.
But there was not a single word from the book in that thing. And then
and
it was a cover story, and somebody brought that to her notice. And then she doesn't like anyone to write about her, especially in English, I think. So she went to court.
Without even talking to you or reading the book or knowing what's
written? No, without reading. Mm. And the judge brought a stay, you know, which was very surprising.
Okay.
Which you never hear of, you know, a book being prevented from getting released. And you get a stay, and then the case went on. The Penguin fought the case for a year in the Sessions Court and lost. And they gave up.
Okay.
You know, you can't do otherwise with a person like Jayalalitha.
All powerful.
Because the judge also gave such an indictment of the book.
Now, regarding the second book, so the book in question now. To tell you frankly, I was told about this interview just 2 days ago. I was requested, and I was wondering, you know, whether I would be able to do it. I mean, to read a book takes some time.
But
when I went to the bookstore and I saw it, I was I accepted. I called up and told the organizers that I would take it up because it seemed easy to finish. But I was wondering how you could have distilled, you know, so much of information into such a slim book. I was expecting a huge volume with fine print and all that. And when I saw this, I said, how is it possible? She's such a larger than life figure and such a complex person that there are so many sides to her personality. How was it possible to distill all of that into such a slim volume?
Have I done it?
I'll leave you to answer that.
No, the thing is, they suddenly came and asked me, you know, I have shifted to Delhi.
Okay.
I was in Bangalore, I've shifted to Delhi. They came and asked me. Then again, I was nervous. You know, this injunction had such a psychological impact on me. It was so scary. You can ask my friends here. I haven't visited Chennai at all after the injunction because it was so scary, and people said it's not safe at all for you to travel to Chennai.
Would you have done this interview in Chennai?
Now, yes. When she was alive.
No, but her fans are there still, isn't it?
No, but still, I suppose, less powerful than...
Okay.
There was an atmosphere of fear those days in the corridors of power. If you were a journalist there, you would have realized the kind of fear that was generated. She had that capacity to generate fear. And so when these people came and asked me, this juggernaut people, again I was nervous, you know. It was like something hot, which I didn't want to touch. And then I consulted my legal advisor, but this people, juggernaut people said, oh, don't worry about it. This is going to be only less than 30,000 words for a phone app. Then I consulted my legal advisor, who is a dear friend, and then he said, don't bother about it. It is only a phone app. And many people anyway don't know to access a phone app. So especially ADM came in. So
were you given any instructions or were there any conditions that you should not be, raise anything controversial?
No, she perhaps, you know, it was nothing like that. They didn't pinpoint to anything specific. The objections raised were very, you know, they were all laughable. Like I had written her original name was Komalavalli. Then she said, oh, that's a lie. They said it was always Jayalalitha. So that kind of a thing. And then they said it is a kind of an invasion into privacy, her privacy. So, but then everything was in the public domain. Whatever I have written, it is only my perception as a woman and as a journalist. I have written that book.
I was coming to that. What was your perception of her? I'll just read out a few lines from the book, from the preface. She's enigmatic, she's imperious, she's adored, and she's feared. She's deified by her admirers and reviled by her opponents. When she's up in the sky in her helicopter, her devotees fall on the ground and prostrate, just as they would in her presence. She stands apart, unreal and gigantic, just like those cutout hoardings that her party workers had erected along the streets of Tamil Nadu. So yeah. That is how you start the book.
Yeah.
So she was such a complex person. What was your perception of her as a person? As a daughter, as an ally of a political party, as a chief minister, as a friend, as an enemy.
Not my friend. I don't think she was anybody's friend. Because she disowned her own close friends, supposedly very close, you know, friends. No, the thing, whatever I gathered from her friends, you know, was very interesting. They said that she was a very charming girl. She was so intelligent, very intelligent. She would sometimes come to the class totally unprepared because some late night party was there before. And she would come and then she would just glance at the pages of the book and then she would stand first in the test. And so she was a brilliant girl. She was a fun-loving girl. All that. Later on, I don't know, there was some kind of an anger in her. That is what I heard from her friends and a friend, very close friend, with whom she, you know, she cut off all the contacts. Her contacts deliberately.
Yeah,
that is very surprising.
Anyone else except Sashikala.
Yeah.
Oh, we'll come to that later. But meanwhile, I'd just like you to say a few words about her her political debut. When she made that maiden speech, that famous maiden speech in Cuddalore.
Mm.
There was so much of rancor among the opposition. They used such obscene language, besides calling that whole episode the Cuddalore cabaret.
Yeah.
So can you tell us about...
No, the thing is, her whole life, you know, it has been a kind of a fighting against the system, against the established system. And she first, you know, she wanted to pursue her studies, then she couldn't do it because her mother forced her into acting. And then there, the cinema world, Tamil cinema world, was very male-dominated. And she got to know MGR and M.G. Ramachandran, who was a matinee idol at the time, most popular, most powerful. And she have acted with him, though there was 30 years difference between the two. And she became his co-star in many films.
And apart from being, you just said
no,
that...
No, I tell you, I come to that. So then she entered politics when her roles were diminishing in the film world. She was not getting good roles. And then she thought, you know, this is the best way to do something for the thing. When she, some people asked her why she joined politics. And then she very naively, you know, quoted Mahatma Gandhi's words. You know, Mahatma Gandhi said, God has given us this body to serve humanity. And so that's what she said. This body is to serve humanity. I want to help people. And so, of course, the first meeting was in Cuddalore, her maiden speech, and then that was a big success. And then the DMK poster said, this Kadalur Cabaret. You come and listen to this Kadalur Cabaret. But then when she said this, that this body is to serve people, then they also said, oh, come boys, young men of Tamil Nadu, here is a person who is willing to give her body to the service of young men, use of it.
So that's what I was just going to say. So you said the Tamil film world was male-dominated. Also the political world was completely male-dominated.
And sexist.
So she entered this, she had so many disadvantages. She was a Brahmin entering this, the ADMK party, which had its roots in anti-Brahminical stance. And then she was a woman, she was an actress. How did she come so far?
Yeah, she was a fighter. She was a fighter and she would never accept defeat. That was her basic nature. It is that motivated her throughout her life, you know. That is the thing, the spirit to fight and challenge and to be the winner in the end. And so there were three disadvantages that she fought through, and she came out of it not merely as a big leader, she was deified. You know, I think she's one of the very rare leaders who was loved and also feared. You know, deified. She was deified. She, the thing is, her story is not only the story of a woman who, how difficult it is for a woman to be successful in the male-dominated political world, but it is also a story of a woman who transforms herself to stay in that and then be a winner. You know, she formed her own strategies throughout. You know, the first regime, the first regime was a kind of a disaster, I mean, politically. Though she, because, you know, she came with an absolute majority after this Rajiv Gandhi's assassination and all that. And it just, it was a kind of a release for her, because before that, she was mortally scared of her future. Because though people, the cadres thought of her as very close to MGR and called her Anni, as you know, the wife of elder brother. In Tamil, one says Anni. So he was Annan and she was Anni. But then MGR just betrayed her, you know, for all the things. I mean, the outside world, she looked like her mentor. But then it was actually a betrayal. He had given her no official position, nothing. She even desperately wanted to marry him, you know, just 2 years before his death.
You mentioned that in your book.
Yeah, and she wanted to marry him, which is very strange because she was not even aware of his physical ailments and all. Because to legitimize her relationship. But nothing happened. He just left her in the lurch, and there was absolute fear in her about her future, and she must have been scheming devices, you know, how to stand on her own. And so this victory in 1991 was a big triumph for her, because it liberated her from that fear,
you
know, and from that, you know, the talisman that she thought was MGR was the talisman, and it was a kind of a liberation.
Coming out on her own.
Yeah, but I think she went berserk because of that feeling. And so it was a free-for-all during her regime, and everyone was corrupt, and it was known for corruption. And
so if you were to evolve, trace her evolution as a chief minister, she has served, she served four terms as chief minister. So how would you, trace her evolution? The first, second, third, fourth.
What happened the first time? You know, she was charged with all the corruption charges, and so many, about 26 cases were against her. And, it didn't kind of mellow her. I won't say all those experiences mellowed her, but it made her more determined to fight. And then, of course, she came back the second time. The second time, vengeance was her name. you know. And because she was imprisoned by Karunanidhi, that must have been a terrible thing for her. Yeah, I mean, living like a queen and then going like a common criminal and staying in the prison. It's a very fascinating life, I should say. Because you see how her complex behavior became more complex and how she steeled herself to face all the obstacles that came. And then this second regime, she arrested Karunanidhi, and then of course the whole nation, you know, rose against it. And so she realized her fault. But the second regime, she came out with so many strictures and laws and ordinances and all that were that people never liked. Okay. You know, it was anti-people, the DMK called. So in that, people forgot her administrative ability as well, the way she managed tsunami, and then Veerappan, that sandalwood bandit, was captured and all. She gave full freedom to the police. There were a lot of things.
So you think,
you know,
she's a good administrator?
She was. She could take decisions, and people obeyed her. That is the thing, the bureaucracy. And Tamil Nadu also had this good fortune of having a line of good bureaucrats. And they did, because she was so commanding. And they respected her, you know. They always respect a leader who gives very clear
instructions,
and then they also give them full freedom. So, but all those things were forgotten because of all the
corruption charges.
The second regime was not of corruption, but because of the kind of bold action she took, and she suddenly brought a Sumoto thing about converting Queen Mary's College, more than 100-year-old college, into, you know, the Senate House and all that, and prohibiting animal sacrifice, which went against the rural folk. And like this, there were a lot of unpopular decisions she took. So then also the Karunanidhi came out with a fantastic election manifesto, which said we will distribute free TVs and all. So all the women were taken over by that, though Karunanidhi was never very popular with the women voters. So the second regime she lost. And then the third regime, when she came back, she realized that she had to again transform into the benevolent mother. The first she was a sister. You know, I have attended her election campaigns before the second victory. She would spread her pallu in front of her, you know. In Tamil, we say, we have an expression called madipichai. You know, madipichai means you just spread the pallu and beg for alms. She would be bereft of all the jewelry because all those things were sealed because of the corruption charges, without earrings, without any jewelry. A person who was decked and so beautiful, she would be there like a kind of a sadhu,
ascetic,
and then say, "I am asking for alms. Please, sisters, vote for your sister." I have. And then she projected herself as the wrongdoer, Draupadi. Okay. You know, how, because she, I have written in the book how she was molested
in the first assembly
and all. Mm. So all these things appealed to the women.
Okay.
So that is how she won, and she could project herself as the wrongdoer. But in the third regime, she mellowed. That is, she realized that she had to project herself as the giver, the benevolent mother. And so she became Amma too. And everything was in her name. Mm. You see, it was Amma's regime only.
So she promoted herself blatantly.
Absolutely, and without any this thing, you know, she has no qualms about it. And Amma this, Amma that, everywhere Amma. And so it has a terrific impact on the Tamil psyche.
It resonated, you know, everywhere.
Mm-hmm. And no, the Tamil sayings, there are, you know, very pop household sayings like never forget the person who has given you salt or who has fed you. All these things are said every day in the house. And so people couldn't forget her, the kind of canteens, the subsidized canteens, and nobody went hungry. And actually all her welfare schemes made the life of ordinary women more comfortable, the poor women more comfortable. And
do you think these freebies and these subsidies in any way came in the way of developmental activities?
Of course, there's an economist, Sushila Ravindranath, will be able to tell you. But then it is a political strategy.
Yes.
Everywhere, you see, all these freebies and all these...
But if you were to list some of her other achievements, what would you say? Any landmark achievements that you can think of? You all mentioned Veerappan, capturing Veerappan, which is a big thing. Then also managing the tsunami.
And also to a certain extent, the water management and all that, you know. She was the first person to bring about this water harvest, rainwater harvesting. She made it mandatory for everyone to have it in their houses. And then she brought this female infanticide was going on. That happened in cradle system she brought. And then, but of course, I wrote a very blasting column against her, this thing called, you know, there were big statements, posters and placards and all that, which would say, give us the girl baby that you do not want. So I said it was a very negative propaganda, and it wouldn't motivate any woman to. But actually what happened was it had a backlash. While the government claimed that female infanticide had stopped completely, it wasn't true. It took another shape. Suddenly the birthright of female children went down drastically. So, and then I did a story. Yeah. I went to all small towns, and even in small towns near Salem and other places, there were scanning centers. And then people didn't want to entrust their babies to the government. Mm. They didn't know what would happen to the kids.
So they'd rather abort the child.
Yeah.
Okay. But how did she manage? I think you've forgotten to mention one thing which you have in your book, how she managed the LTT. How she controlled
the LTT. Yeah. That is a very important thing. Yeah, sorry. She was a person who persuaded the center to ban LTT. She was very strict about it. In the first regime, that was her biggest achievement, because there was so much of lawlessness, and the LTT
had spread
all over Tamil Nadu, and then all of them were rounded up. And then, so she claimed that under her regime, the Tamil Nadu had become a garden of peace.
Okay. So any discussion on Jayalalitha, of course, cannot be complete without the mention of Seshikala. So can you give us some insights about it? Because we talk about Jayalalitha as being enigmatic and, you know, very mysterious, but Seshikala is even more so. I've never heard her speak anywhere. Of course, the little that we know about her background, apart from that, how was she as a person? And is she all the kind of vile insinuations that people made about their relationship?
Jayalalitha's death, Seshikala was as enigmatic as Jayalalitha was. But after her death, now that she has started opening her mouth, to me, she is no longer enigmatic. Okay. Now we know what she is and what she is up to.
But she's likely to take over the mantle from Jayalalitha. How would you feel about that? How would she fare?
No, I don't think anybody can do that. Mm-hmm. I don't think so. Just because she was a shadow of Jayalalitha in her house, and supposedly just a housekeeper. Supposedly. She, of course, had her own machinations with the political party, and then all these ministers and MLAs and all who owe allegiance to her, because it was she who kind of recommended their names for party tickets and all that. Naturally,
so she has her own coterie.
They have got 2 feet to fall to now, another 2 feet.
Okay. So you've talked about the DMK versus the Anna DMK. In the DMK, you have Karunanidhi surrounded by his very large family. And you have Jayalalitha on the other hand with no one, except from for this friend who suddenly came from nowhere. How would you see this person surrounded by this whole family? Was that to his advantage? Was it to his advantage or disadvantage?
Versus
Jayalalitha.
Yeah, that is the advantage of a male politician also. He has a lot of people, colleagues and all that. And but Karunanidhi's one weakness was promoting his own family, all the members of the family in one way or the other. But otherwise, he had a lot of advisors and all very sharp people and all that. But Jayalalitha chose her life to be so. And also the Tamil ethos, prevented her from getting too close to men in her own party or anything, because that is the reason why I feel that she even allowed ministers to fall at her feet. First, she must have been kind of amused, or it would have been a kind of a triumphant feeling as well, because the male society had insulted, humiliated her so much. And when it falls at your feet, you must have felt, you must feel elated. I would be, I think. And but then, it was also another strategy to keep men away. And also it would create a lot of gossip if she was too near these men or consulted them frequently, having meetings and all that. So she avoided that, I think.
She maintained it. Distance.
Yeah, and she was a recluse and she was very imperious that way. I think she developed that herself into that kind of a charisma. Okay.
So before she became the chief minister for the first time, and when she was distanced for a while from MGR, she developed a relationship with a Telugu actor, Shobhan Babu. You've written about that in a very poignant way in your book. Because she was expecting to marry him, and then it didn't come about. So why was that? Why didn't it happen? And if she had married him, it would the Tamil politics would have taken a different course altogether.
Yeah, we wouldn't be talking about her now at all. Probably she would have settled in Hyderabad, looking after her grapevines and all. No, the thing is, she almost married him. Actually, she had two friends with whom I have contact. One friend said that she actually saw an album where Jayalalitha showed her pictures of marriage actually happening with a priest, and she having a regular Tamil Iyengar wedding and all that, lot of pictures. But then the other friend who was very close, she told me the wedding never happened. I don't know how the album came about and
whether it was true or not.
No, both husband and wife vouched for its existence. That is what is surprising. But then the other friend told me that the marriage was to take place. Jayalalitha had arranged everything. She had even bought a sari from Nalli and asked this girl, this friend of hers, who was also an Iyengar, to have an Iyengar Thali, Mangal Sutra, get ready. And she said, you come to my house at 7 o'clock or something like that. But at 6 o'clock, she called her friend and then said the marriage is cancelled.
That's very sad.
Yeah. And she didn't give any reason at that time. And then later, it seems she told her friend that Shobhan Babu's wife objected to it. Shobhan Babu was already married and he had a son.
you were asked to write a biography on any Indian, contemporary Indian politician, would you
no
do
more.
It?
No more. I've had enough of such traumatic years after this injunction.
Okay. Thank you. And then please, I will ask the audience to come up with any questions that they may have.
Writing about Jayalalitha must be equally a dynamic and a bold person. So congratulations.
Oh, no.
secondly,
that's
I...
That's not true. You do not know how scared I was.
Understand.
I understand. So scared. After the injunction, I didn't want to go to Chennai. I didn't want to face the... I couldn't open my mouth on Tamil Nadu politics at all. I stopped writing about Tamil Nadu politics. It was so scary. No, don't compare me with Jayalalitha.
No, but still, we admire you for your courage and your, you know, your willingness to write. And is Penguin planning to bring out that book again now?
I don't know.
What about this juggernaut? I mean, this hard copy that it's come out. What about the sales of it? Has it you know, kind of made any kind of impact?
Plummeted. Actually, I am being vindicated now because. I'm told that it is in the bestseller list of Amazon.
Congratulations, and you Thank deserve you. It.
Thank you.
What's the final word about her death? Was it natural? Was it not natural?
Nobody knows. I think even Dr. Pratap Reddy is not aware. I do not know.
Okay. Ma'am, I just have one question.
Yeah.
What is your assessment about Jayalalitha as a leader? Given the fact that there are two issues. One, she comes from a community which is not predominant in Tamil politics. Secondly, she is a person who didn't have a political background, unlike Indira Gandhi or Benazir Bhutto or Kalidas.
Yeah, she was a very charismatic leader. She had that kind of charisma, though she. I mean, she just grew above all this, beyond all this, caste, gender and all that. That is something amazing, how she became a mass leader. And also her claim that she was the chosen heir of MGR, M.G. Ramachandran, who was much loved by the masses. And so that helped her, but then she also had her charismatic, presence before the masses. She was very intelligent. She planned her way through. It is not just like it was just spontaneous or anything. Every move of hers was a very studied strategy. That is what I feel after studying her so deeply.
Ma'am, we always heard Amma speak good English. Since we are in the literary fest, ma'am, what's her depth in literature? Is she well read?
Sorry, I can't. She did her 10th class only, but I think she used to read a lot. But I had a feeling that she stopped reading after she became a chief minister.
Madam Jayalalitha, from, as you said, male dominated cine world, male dominated politics, she made it up in both the places. Is she worthy of emulating?
I don't think anybody can emulate another person. Yeah, she was a kind of, you could say, a role model who fought. But I honestly feel that throughout her political career, her main motivation was to fight Karunanidhi, her enemy. I think the Tamil Nadu politics was shaped to a large extent by the enmity between these two leaders.
But was she not unique in her own way?
No, she could be a role model for women because, she fought her way through despite all the disadvantages she had. So, yes, she could be a role model.
So, with that, we come to the end of this session.
Yeah, not a question. Just wanted to say we'd like to thank the organizers for making this possible for us. Because, Dr. Sunita also came up with all the questions that we would have wanted to, ask of her, and the most celebrated author here giving us a glimpse of this, enigmatic person that we always wanted to know about.
Thank you.
It was not a dull moment, a most engaging and lively conversation.
Thank you. The title is Amma, Jayalalitha's journey from movie star to political queen. Okay. With that, we come to the end of this session. Thank you all so much for being a wonderful audience. And thank you, ma'am.